There is a model in particle physics which is so successful that it has correctly predicted nearly 15 million billion experiments. It is a highly detailed theory which explains the structure of the matter in the universe with incredible success. But what's really surprising for me is that for the past few years, some scientists have been trying to prove this model wrong.
I'm here at CERN today, one of the leading institutes for particle physics in the world.
10 years ago, they discovered the Higgs boson, and that completed the standard model as we know it. But today, that model is way too successful for its own good. Let's talk about that.
Okay, let's talk about the standard model for a bit, and I'll try and make it as simple as possible, but if it feels too complicated, please feel free to skip this part, because all you need to know is that the standard model is the most successful theory in particle physics that there is. Thank you, Achintya, for doing this.
Pleasure.
This is Achintya Rao. He is a community manager at the Alan Turing Institute in the UK. But prior to that, he was a science communicator for well over a decade at CERN.
So the standard model of particle physics is a theoretical framework that has been assembled over decades. This is a theory that encapsulates all of the known particles in the universe and three of the four known forces.
Okay, let me start by asking you this. If I tear this piece of paper, and then I tear it again, and then again, and then again, and I continue doing this for infinite number of times, what's the smallest elementary particle of matter that I'll be left with? Well, one of the answers for that could be this, an electron. Now, I'm guessing most of you would be familiar with what an electron is. In case of the standard model, the electron actually belongs to a family of elementary matter particles. And you might have heard of a few of them, like the electron over here, or even the neutrinos, or what is my personal favorite, the strange particle. Just has a very cool name. So apart from these particles, which constitute for all the matter in the observable universe, we also have force particles. So these force particles, if I were to put it in a very, very crude manner, would be the particles responsible for the forces around us. So consider something like a photon. It is a force particle responsible for the electromagnetic fields. Similarly, we have gluons for the strong forces, and we have W and Z bosons for the weak forces. And so now we know what the matter in the universe is made up of. We know how the forces exist. But how do these particles get their masses? That's the crown jewel of the standard model, or the Higgs boson. The Higgs boson, apart from the electron, is probably the most famous particle. It was only recently discovered in 2012, and it was the biggest news that you could see in that year. But importantly for us, this Higgs boson is what's responsible for the masses of all matter.
The standard model came to be assembled when people began discovering more and more particles, and they began realizing that some of the forces are related to one another. The reason we see that the standard model is very successful is that not only has it provided us with this explanation of the particles, how they interact with each other, and the forces that are responsible for those interactions, it has also made predictions. As a mathematical framework behind the physical world, it can make predictions about how particles will be produced, how particles will transform once they're produced, and so forth. And so it has been making predictions for the last several decades, and the predictions have always been right. They've always been spot on.
How are the experiments conducted in order to verify the standard model and its predictions?
There are a wide variety of experiments that are performed at CERN, but I guess it might be worth focusing on the Large Hadron Collider, which is the flagship accelerator. And what you do with this big 27 kilometer circumference machine, which is located about 100 meters underground, is you accelerate protons. You accelerate them in clockwise and counterclockwise directions. You accelerate them to very, very high velocities so that the energy that is imparted to the particles as a consequence of the velocities to which they're accelerated can be transformed into matter when you smash those protons together. So these collisions take place, they produce new matter, and then you have detectors around them that are pretty much like the camera that you have. So your cameras are registering photons that are bouncing off of you and me. You have sensors inside these detectors that detect photons, that detect electrons, that detect composite particles like neutrons, and then you study phenomena that were predicted by the standard model. So when you collide two particles together, the standard model says, okay, you will produce an epsilon particle at this rate, you will produce a Higgs boson at this rate. Every so many collisions, you will produce this. You record those collisions, and then you see whether the standard model has made the prediction correctly or not.
This picture of the standard model is the work of some of the greatest minds of science in the past so many decades. But unfortunately, it's still not complete.
But there are some reasons why scientists believe that it is not a complete picture of the universe. Mm-hmm. The most obvious reason being that the standard model doesn't tell you anything about gravity.
Gravity is the biggest challenge for the standard model, because even though we experience it every single day in the realm of particle physics, we know very little about it. And what really adds to the problem is that outside of the particle physics realm, we have a very successful theory for gravity in itself.
Albert Einstein came up with the theory of relativity, but it still doesn't answer all the questions that we have.
Now, the problem with modern physics is that these two very successful theories do not talk to each other very well. The theory of relativity breaks down in the particle realm, and the standard model is not very successful outside of it. This creates the biggest fork in modern physics, and it also poses the greatest challenge that we have. And the challenge is to find the unified theory of everything.
If they were to be unified, we might expect that a particle associated with gravity might be found. So the other forces have a force carrier, like the electromagnetic field has, the photon as a force carrier and so forth, that gravity might have a force carrier called the graviton. And if we were to find this particle, then that would say, all right, there is a means of unifying the standard model of particle physics with gravity.
Which brings us back to exactly where we started from. It's been 10 years since CERN has been studying the Higgs boson, and we understand a lot more about it.
And the same goes for the standard model. It still gives the correct prediction every single time. But we know for sure that this model is not complete. There is physics beyond this model. Gravity, like we discussed, is one of those issues, but there are so much more. So it's a very scary thought that the most successful model that the humankind ever came up with is incomplete and possibly even wrong.
How important is to actually fail in science? How important is that for the progress of science?
That's a question that a lot of people have spent a lot of time thinking about.
You see, the point of modern science is to create disagreements that lead to resolutions through experiments and mathematics. I'm taking the liberty of being very crude over here, but it's important that the theories that we stood upon once break down to give way to new theories so that we can find what's remaining of this universe.
Going back, you know, almost 200 years ago, the Michelson-Morley experiment trying to find luminiferous ether in space was an idea that was very much in vogue, very much believed by the smartest people at the time. We didn't find it, and that null result was extremely valuable for then laying the path for special relativity and general relativity to come. Historically, finding null results is very valuable. Null results tells you what doors are worth closing and where other ones might open up for you.
I find it incredibly poetic that to understand where we came from, to understand where this universe all began, we need to let go of the most successful model in the history of mankind. I kind of like that a lot, to be fair. Anyways, I think I should end the video now. Thank you so much for watching this very first episode of SciPhi. There's a lot more to come, and I'll see you in the next one. Well, if you made it till the end of the video, I think you'll be interested in watching the extended interview with Achintya. In contrast to the more philosophical part over here, we go much deeper into the physics side of the standard model. I think you'll find a lot of interesting bouncing off points from wherein you can make your own research. That's it.